Hello, my name is Karsten Müller. I'm an assistant professor of finance at the National University of Singapore. And today we're going to be talking about the allocation of credit in the economy and why you should care about it. So ever since the 2007-08 financial crisis, economists have studied why is it that sometimes we get these systemic banking crises that are often followed by really protracted long recessions. So they're really bad for the economy. We often see spikes in unemployment afterwards and often even political crises. And one commonality that people have identified is that in the run-up to these crises, you often see quite a large expansion in credit in the private sector. So there's a lot more lending by banks and other financial institutions, and private households and firms take on a lot more debt. Now, although it's true that these types of crises tend to be preceded by such credit booms, it's not the case that every credit boom ends badly. It's not true that every credit boom ends in such deep recessions and other macroeconomic trouble. Often, it's also the case that credit booms tend to be followed by higher economic growth or even kind of productivity miracles. And so this is where my research comes in and asks, could it be that the allocation of credit, so where in the economy the credit flows, and in particular, which sectors in the economy receive credit during such booms, could that be a partial explanation for the different types of outcomes we see following these credit expansions? So in essence, there are two key hypotheses about how credit could affect the real economy. And so number one is what I would call the easy credit hypothesis. So this is the idea that if you have a change in financing conditions, so for example, a change in monetary policy or a change in banking regulation or any other kind of financial liberalization, then some sectors in the economy, they might receive more credit as a result. And these should particularly be sectors that are very sensitive to financing conditions, perhaps because they have lots of firms that have financial constraints, for example, smaller firms, or perhaps, you know, some sectors receive more credit because they have certain types of collateral that are commonly used, for example, real estate collateral. And then the idea is that, well, if you have a credit boom because of such a change in financing conditions, really nothing has changed in the economy on any fundamental level. There's no fundamental improvement in the economy. And so what can happen is that if a lot of credit flows to these more sensitive sectors, that then as a result of that, ultimately, you can get a crisis once there is kind of a reversal in, you know, the interest rate in the economy or whatever had caused the boom in the first place. And so when we try to think about what types of industries should be particularly sensitive to this easy credit, it should really be industries that are concentrated in the non-tradable sector of the economy. So why non-tradable? Because sectors that are very dependent on the local economy, they often use a lot of real estate collateral, such as construction and real estate, but also other types of non-tradable services like retail trade, local restaurants, and so on. And those industries also tend to have a lot of these smaller firms. And so the idea here essentially is that the non-tradable sector, firms in the non-tradable sector in particular, they should react a lot to these financing conditions, and that can ultimately end up in these financial crises and macroeconomic problems. Now, the second hypothesis about credit expansions is what I would call the productivity enhancing credit boom hypothesis. So here the idea is that sometimes there might be some fundamental improvement in the economy, some kind of productivity shock, or perhaps there's a change in the financial sector that makes it easier for banks and other financial institutions to get credit to the firms that really are most deserving of it in some sense, that are the most productive firms in the economy. And if that is the source of a credit boom, then we should see credit flowing to sectors that are typically very productive, that have a high level of productivity. And it turns out that Those types of firms tend to be concentrated in the tradable sector of the economy, particularly in manufacturing, at least kind of in a historical perspective. And so if you see a lot of credit flowing to these kinds of sectors, what that could mean then is that really this is kind of a good thing for the economy, and that can be actually followed by an increase in productivity or an increase in economic growth, and should not really have any association with crises. Now, what I do in my research is to try and measure these things and trace them out in the data. And it turns out that's extraordinarily difficult because there is no readily available data to see, for example, how much credit flows to the construction sector versus manufacturing if you're comparing, say, Belgium and Canada or Australia and Indonesia. And so what I started doing in my PhD and in some follow-up work with Emil Werner is to construct a new data set on the allocation of credit by sector for a broad set of around 120 countries going back all the way to 1940. And with these data, we can then run a series of empirical tests to try and understand why it is that sometimes these credit booms end badly and why sometimes they're associated with these kind of productivity accelerations. And so in essence, we have three major findings coming out of this research. The first finding is that a typical credit boom is associated with credit disproportionately flowing to households and the non-tradable sector in the economy. A typical credit boom does not see an expansion of lending to manufacturing or agriculture. It sees an expansion of credit in the construction sector, real estate, but also retail trade and other kinds of more local services. The second finding is that on average, these credit booms that are concentrated in the non-tradable sector in particular, also household debt booms, those tend to be followed by a systematic slowdown, a kind of a recession, higher recession probability after 4 or 5 years. But if you look at lending to the tradable sector, that on average has a higher level of productivity, those tend to be associated with stable or even higher economic growth in the medium term. And so the kind of third finding is that when you try to understand the mechanisms that might underlie this result, you can kind of see two things. So A, we can see that the non-tradable sector in particular has a particular association with financial crises. So what you see in the data is that lending to the non-tradable sector, firms in the non-tradable sector, is much more likely to be associated with a future banking crisis than if you look at the tradable sector. In fact, the tradable sector does not have much of an association at all with the likelihood of a financial crisis happening. At the same time, once a financial crisis hits, you can see in the data that almost the entirety of the loans going bad during these crises is concentrated among firms in the non-tradable sector. Households play a much smaller role, and the tradable sector essentially plays no role at all in understanding the defaults that happened during these financial crises. And B, in terms of the mechanism, we can also see that if you look at these credit booms in the tradable sector, so lending to the tradable sector, that indeed in the data tends to be followed by an increase in productivity, both labor productivity, but also what's called total factor productivity. And so that suggests that these types of tradable sector credit expansions really seem to be driven by some fundamental improvement in the economy and not just by some changes in financing conditions that then induce some potential macroeconomic problems down the line. So if you take these findings together, I think there are kind of two key takeaways that I believe are important. So number one is that when you're thinking about the credit cycle, or you think about the relationship between finance and the real economy, you really want to think carefully about firm credit. There's been a lot of focus both among regulators, but also the private sector and academics on household debt, and I think rightly so. But what our research shows is that firm credit, firm debt, is also really important. You just have to differentiate what type of firm debt you're looking at. And this difference that we make between the tradable and non-tradable sector seems to be a really important distinction when you're trying to understand the real economic implications of credit pools. The second implication, I think, is something for regulators, but also perhaps financial market participants to consider, which is that if you're thinking about the likelihood of a financial crash, if you're thinking about the likelihood of a market crash, then you really want to take into account the types of credit that you see expanding in the economy that historically have been associated with these bad things. So not all kinds of credit are the same. You really want to focus on the type of risky credit growth that you see happening in the economy. And we hope that our research and the data that we will make publicly available can help in understanding these types of developments better and hopefully allow both regulators and market participants to track these developments in real time.